Well, I'm continuing in Matthew section 5 as I've divided up his gospel, which I've titled with the sentence, "The Suffering King Explains His Kingdom," because that is how Jesus portrays himself in this section, the Suffering King, and he does a lot of explaining about what his kingdom is like. And today's message in particular is continuing this section of teaching that we have from Jesus, which really focuses a lot on Christians interacting with one another and how that's supposed to happen, and very often how that's not supposed to happen in the Christian life. So far, Jesus has enforced the need for not seeking to be greater than one another, for receiving one another, and for not making one another stumble. So if you go through the passages we've been through so far in this time of teaching from Jesus, those are the sorts of things we've seen so far. Now this time, Jesus takes matters in a slightly different direction, but still very much on the topic of Christians dealing with one another. And this is on Christians not despising one another. And we're in verse 10, really, which is what I'm about to read. And while that's maybe to be expected, you know, to hear him say that we should not despise one another, after all, you should love your neighbor as yourself, you think that would go double for your brothers and sisters in Christ, which is who disciples are to one another. Very expected, but the reasoning he gives for why we should not despise one another leaves a lot of room for discussion. As verse 10 here, so he says, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels in heaven continually see the face of my Father who is in heaven." So that is the command, and that is the reason. The command is not to despise one another. The reason is because their angels are seeing the face of God all the time. So there's enough to discuss there, as you might imagine, that I've dedicated today's message entirely to this one verse. It was either that or just say, and just kind of move on and not deal with it. I decided to be a little more thorough, so we're going to spend the whole message on this one verse here in verse 10. So according to Jesus, considering the role of angels provides a reason that Christians should not despise one another. Now for those of you kids who maybe have not heard the word despise, that just means to really hate something. It's kind of another word for hate. So Jesus is commanding Christians not to despise, not to hate another Christian. And Jesus says that something about angels is going to teach Christians not to despise another Christian. So we're going to figure out what he means by that, and we're going to try to figure out what is going through his mind and what he intends when he says that. My outline has 5 points. So I'll just give them all to you here up front so you can be following along. First, Christians should not despise another Christian. The bare minimum assertion of the verse that is perhaps the easiest to understand. Secondly, Christians should not despise another Christian because of angels. Third, Christians should not despise another Christian because he has angelic protectors. Fourth, Christians should not despise another Christian because his angels have prestige because of him. And then number 5, Christians should not despise another Christian because heaven is united in his favor. So those are the points I want to cover tonight, and we'll do those, I think, very slowly in a way that I think does unpack very carefully what Jesus has in this command. And you might say, or I'm going to say, you may not say this, but I will, this passage demonstrates the earthly good of a heavenly mind. That's the phrase that came to my mind as I was studying this passage, and I thought it was catchier than don't hate each other. So that's my title for this message, the earthly good of a heavenly mind. So there, that's what came to my mind as I was studying this. And on the one hand, you do see here in this passage how the whole command is dependent upon heavenly realities. I mean, stuff that is real, not just in heaven, but stuff that you can only consider real if your mind is set on those things and accepting of those things in heaven. This is an argument that can only be accepted by someone whose mind is set on those heavenly realities. If you're not thinking of heavenly things as Jesus is, then this argument and this command is just going to be meaningless to you. However, humans in general have a very bad habit of treating such heavenly realities as being more like entertainment than anything. They're just sort of an amusing thing. And I think angels especially get this kind of mistreatment. They are, in a sense, talked about very often, but just as often as they come up, they are trivialized. I mean, people like to have paintings of angels. They like to make movies and TV shows based on angels. They like to have little, you know, angel necklaces or statues or whatever, but it's all just kind of like fluff. It's not really anything substantial about these angels. The idea that the existence and the presence and the labor of angels, the idea that that might be important for you right now, is really foreign to most people, being really so earthly minded that any thought of heavenly things is just kind of out there or brought in just as kind of an entertaining thing or something that makes you feel good or whatever. So Jesus kind of plows through that. He does have a very heavenly mind, as you can imagine. His mind is set on heavenly things, but he brings those heavenly thoughts to an earthly conclusion, something you should do on the basis of those heavenly realities, which in this case is not despising one another, that Christians should not despise another Christian. So yes, these angels are quite involved in the lives of Christians, and that's the reason you should not despise any Christian. Jesus could have gone anywhere with this. He could have taken his cue from anything in giving this command about not despising another Christian. Instead, he appeals to a very heavenly reality, angels. And that is what we're going to try to figure out tonight as we determine what his reasoning is and just how it should motivate us not to despise another Christian. But to begin with the very basic point, the command given by Jesus, Christians should not despise another Christian. And if you've not noticed it already, I'm wording that in such a way which makes it sound like many people against one person. Christians, plural, should not despise another Christian, singular. And I'm wording it that way because I think that's what Jesus means. I think that's part of the teaching, part of the commandment here in this verse. Now, before I say anything more, I'll begin by reminding you that these little ones are, in fact, Christians. We are talking about believers when we talk about this command against despising one of these little ones. If you go back to Matthew, we'll just read verse 10 here. See to it that you do not despise one of these little ones. That's how Jesus words it. Now, I provided my full argument some time ago when I spoke about the need of Christians to receive one another, to accept one another in Christ. I made the argument back then that these little ones is how Jesus refers to Christians. All I can do is remind you of that argument now. I don't want to spend a whole chunk of this making that same argument. But Jesus has several times referred to his disciples either as children or as little ones. You know, things along those lines, those kind of diminutive terms. He has very often in Matthew used those terms for disciples. And in this chapter, he tells them toward the beginning to humble themselves like children. So the model for embracing our lowly status is the lowly status of a child. He then proceeds with that illustration, comparing his disciples to little ones, you know, the insignificant ones. And these little ones are Christians, they are believers. Now here's something new for this message. Jesus, I think, has one Christian in view when he gives this command in verse 10. And when I say one, I don't mean a specific Christian that you can name, not like someone who's, you know, Jesus has in mind the name of a specific Christian you should not despise. I just mean that as you think about living these commands, you need to apply them to whatever individual Christian you face at that moment, the one Christian that you are tempted at that time to despise, you should remember this command and not despise that one Christian. Now, here in verse 10, you'll notice, and this is my reasoning for saying that, he doesn't just refer to these little ones, but says, one of these little ones. If you didn't catch that, we'll read verse 10 again. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. Okay? One of them. So he deliberately singles out one, the way he words this. And in fact, Jesus spoke this way earlier in the chapter, back in verse 5. He says, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. So this isn't really new for verse 10. It's just new in that I haven't mentioned it until now. And I have reserved it for this point here because I think it actually fits in a little better here with what I want to talk about. So here in verse 10, just to cover that idea as well, here for the first time, this one Christian faces more than one hostile Christian. Back in verse 5, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. Whoever. It's more of a singular idea. It's kind of a general principle, but whoever is generally a singular term. If you want to look at it grammatically, it's definitely a singular idea. But here in verse 10, you have something a little bit different. Now, you're probably going to miss it just reading an English translation because in English, you can be singular or plural. In Greek, it's one or the other. In Greek, it's either a singular you or a plural you. And here, it's plural. See that you all do not despise one of these little ones. So for the first time in this passage so far, Jesus is envisioning not just one Christian at odds with another Christian, but a whole group of Christians at odds and despising this one believer over here. So this is why I have reserved that point until now. This is the first point where you see Jesus actually drawing attention to the one versus the many, which is here. And that's why I say Christians, plural, should not despise another Christian, singular. So all that to say, as our suffering king explains his kingdom, he expressly forbids his kingdom from causing grief to any one of his subjects. This isn't just generic. This isn't just thinking on the terms of a group level. This is Jesus sticking up for one Christian here, and one Christian here, and one Christian here. He cares about every single one of them. And you might be thinking to yourself, Stan, that's oddly specific. Why would Jesus be so particular about not despising, you know, this one Christian here? You know, would such a thing even happen? You know, surely in the community of believers, where we're all indwelt by Christ, living by the Spirit, you know, with such a model of love as Christ was, surely we would never see a situation in which a whole group of Christians would despise one Christian, kind of gang up on that one Christian and treat him so poorly. Well, if you want my opinion, and whether you want it or not, you're going to get it, but if you want my opinion, I will say this sort of thing happens often. So often that it's a complete travesty to the church that it happens so often. I think there are quite a few lone Christians out there who feel excluded by other believers everywhere they go. I think if you will open your eyes and look, you will see these one Christian, these lone little ones out there who are being despised by the general mass of God's people. I think in some ways they bring it on themselves, whether due to indiscretions or some kind of oddity in their character. I think to some degree you can point to things in them that are the cause of that. But rather than these lone Christians being met with patience, they are rather exiled to the frontiers of the kingdom. The rest of God's people are just like, well, you just kind of ignore him, maybe he'll go away. You know, maybe he'll get the hint eventually that we don't really like him. It does happen, and I know this because somehow they always find me. And I'm telling you this based on personal experience. I'm the one who gets stuck with these lone Christians so often. I don't know why, but I so often hear the phrase, oh, Stan, you're the only one I can talk to. It's just, I didn't volunteer for that, but somehow, maybe I'm on the frontier too. Maybe I've been pushed to the side too, and you all are thinking, well, that Stan's a weirdo. Let's just shove him aside. Maybe that's why I always find them. But somehow, they come to me. I can think of more than one Christian that I've met that just generally is not treated well by other Christians and feel like they have nobody except maybe one confidant that they can go to. It does happen very often. So yes, it's important enough for Jesus to say this, that Christians should not despise another Christian, that in a church of people, there should not be this one Christian kind of over here that no one talks to, that no one treats well, that nobody loves. It does happen. I will also say on that point that even if that were not the case, it is helpful for another reason. That to think of this in terms of one Christian is also very helpful for your own application of it. Because it's easy to see this in the abstract and say, oh yeah, we shouldn't despise another Christian. He's a brother in Christ. She's a sister in Christ. Of course you wouldn't despise that Christian. Well then, they're right there with you. You know, this one Christian that maybe for some reason you are seriously tempted to despise. You just don't like this person. You hold this person in disdain privately, if you were to be honest with yourself. If you can learn to think, however, that this command is for this one person there in front of you, it'll be all the weightier. It'll be all the more forceful in getting you to snap out of that mode and realize yourself, okay, I can't do this. I can't treat this person this way. I can't treat this one person this way. I've got to take this command from Christ and apply it right here, right now, to this one Christian in front of me. So either way, whether that's the reality of the lone Christian that is far too common, or just in your own personal application of it to anyone, thinking in this way I think is very helpful, and I think that's why Jesus brings it across that way, that Christians should not despise another Christian, singular. But of course, that's not the most tantalizing thing Jesus says in this command. He says that Christians should not despise another Christian because of angels. That is his whole argument. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you, their angels in heaven continually see the face of my Father who is in heaven. So appealing to the angels. And even if it's hard for you to believe, Jesus expected this argument to be understood by his disciples. He expected them to hear that and actually get it and do something with it. Now, I'm pretty sure you've read this verse several times over the years as you've been reading the Bible and probably said to yourself, huh, that's something to study later. You know, that's something to figure out, you know, down the road. Or maybe I'll hear some sermon on it sometime that'll really open my eyes to what that means. Maybe tonight's that night. Who knows? We'll see what happens. But for my part, that's what I've been doing all these years, just kind of reading that and saying, huh, why did he make that argument? What does he mean by that? Well, I'll figure that out later. And then I said I would teach you through the Gospel of Matthew, and now I have to come to this verse and figure it out. So that's where I am. So a few months ago, I had to sit down and actually start thinking about this and say, hey, you know, what's going on here? Why does Jesus make this argument? But the fascinating thing is, as much as we've kind of thought about it and not really sat there and pegged down what Jesus means, why he makes this argument, it seems like he expected his disciples to get it right away. And I say that because he makes the argument so briefly. I mean, he just says it and moves right on. I mean, there's nothing after verse 11 that's really relevant to that. I mean, he says verse 10 and then verse 11 is something else. He just moves on. It's like he expected them to get it in that moment without further explanation. Really interesting. I mean, we sit here, we're kind of scratching our heads about it, but he expected the disciples to just get it. Furthermore, not just in the time of Jesus and in this moment when Jesus is teaching these disciples here, but Matthew, the author of our gospel here, also, I think, expected his readers to understand Jesus' argument right here and now. I think for the same reason for thinking that Jesus expected his disciples to understand this argument, because Matthew provides no explanation either. He doesn't provide any kind of parentheses to help you understand why Jesus said this. He just kind of moves on. Very interesting. Matthew expects you to get this. In fact, we might say that Matthew is perhaps the only one of the gospel authors who expected his readers to get this, because he is the only one to record this teaching. Mark and Luke, for example, who record this same general passage of teaching about Christians interacting with one another, they skip this. They just don't even include this command about not despising another Christian because of these angels. They don't even bother. And John passes over the whole teaching altogether. But Matthew is like, oh yeah, my readers will get this. Boom, verse 10. And now here we are all this time later saying, huh, I wonder why Jesus would say that and say it that way. So yeah, Jesus, he expects his disciples to get this argument right away. Matthew seems to expect his readers to get it without any help. Very interesting. But it led me to a conclusion that is not exactly novel, not exactly, awe-inspiring, but it led me to a conclusion nonetheless that we should interpret this argument based on Jewish ideas regarding angels. It's hardly a new way to read this verse. My, commentators that I consult do much the same thing, so it's not anything new, but it's commonly done because of everything I just said about both Jesus and Matthew expecting their respective audiences to understand this argument with very little explanation. If one Jew expects that other Jews to understand this statement, and a book written to Jews includes it, while other books written to Gentiles don't bother, there's a pretty good bet there's something Jewish happening here. I mean, that Jesus with his Jewish disciples expected them to get this. Matthew with his Jewish audience, he expected them to get it. But, the other gospel authors writing more to Gentiles, they just say, well, skip that part. They're not going to get it. I mean, it's kind of the thing that makes you think, oh, this must be a very Jewish feature of this gospel. Must be a very Jewish element of this teaching from Jesus. So the rest of this message really is dedicated to finding information on uniquely Jewish beliefs regarding angels and determining whether it will help us make sense of Jesus' argument. So we're going to go and try to get ourselves really in the mindset of the Jews, specifically the disciples maybe, who first heard Jesus teach this way. Now much of that's going to take us to the Old Testament. Of course, that should be your bottom line source for Jewish beliefs. I mean, it is the Word of God that came to them. Some information I'm going to take from later Jewish writings from about the time period when Jesus ministered, ancient Jewish writings like that. We can also go some to the New Testament because most of the New Testament was written by Jews who therefore carry over some of their, Jewish beliefs into things. And so, basically, we're looking at a lot of scripture for this, and then maybe some things from other Jewish writings. So not anything too terribly difficult, but a very deliberate Jewish approach. Now, before I get into that, I do want to make one observation here under this point about Jesus appealing to these angels in this way in his argument. In following his thoughts as well as we can, we're going to find that Jesus' argument is not an ethical argument, but a theological argument. Not an ethical argument, but a theological argument. You might say, not an earthly argument, but a heavenly argument. Now, if it were an ethical argument, Jesus would have appealed to basic ideas regarding right and wrong. That's what ethics is. It's the study of right and wrong. He would have appealed to basic ethical ideas, and he would prove from those basic principles that we should not despise another Christian. He would have done it like that. This, however, is not an ethical argument. I prefer to call it a theological argument because in this case, Jesus is taking actual doctrine. He's taking belief. He's taking articles of faith and applying them to a situation, which I consider very different from a standard ethical argument. See, ethical arguments are strictly horizontal. They regard to how people relate to other people. And they take principles for how people relate to other people and seek to apply those principles to, broader situations, more difficult situations, and say, well, in this situation, you should act this way because of this thing we do. And that's basically how ethics works. If you've ever taken an ethics class, maybe in college, or read any kind of ethical textbook, that's basically how it goes. It's very horizontal. Ethics is a very human concern. And it's very much regarding how people treat other people. And you would think Jesus would take that approach because he's talking about how these Christians ought to relate to this one Christian over here that everyone despises. But instead, Jesus makes a different kind of argument. He makes a theological argument, a heavenly argument, or you might say a vertical argument. Whereas ethics is a horizontal kind of argument, theology is a vertical kind of argument. It's coming from the top down. It's God revealing himself to man saying, I am God, do as I say. Or here are certain truths about how things are, now live accordingly. It's that kind of thing. And in a vertical argument, people are always at the bottom. You know, we are certainly not the supreme beings of the universe. There are creatures above us who have more glory, and above all things is God himself. We find ourselves at the bottom of a very vertical situation when we deal with theology. And that is how Jesus takes, that's the approach he takes in this verse. He appeals to angels, something quite beyond humans, something far more glorious than what we encounter in everyday life, a revealed point of faith that there are angels out there doing God's will. And for that reason, for that very reason, it is very easy to take Jesus' argument lightly. To just kind of say, well, okay, fine, Jesus, whatever. You know, what we've been doing for years is we've been reading our Bibles and not really dealing with verse 10. What I was doing for several years and not really bothering with it. Like, oh, yeah, okay, Jesus appealing to angels. Well, I'll come back to that later. Let's move on to something more tangible, something more earthly, something I can get my hands around. Very easy to treat this kind of argument lightly. It's like the moment you hear the word angels, your mind just checks out. Or you say, well, I'll deal with that later. It can't be that important. He's talking about angels. I mean, they're up there somewhere. I'm down here on earth. This is where things matter for me. It's very easy to do that. Against that temptation, let's remember that the world is much bigger than you, and the universe is much bigger than your world. You know, this earth is a very small speck, even in the physical universe. And then the heavenly universe is much bigger than that. I mean, there is so much to reality, so much that God has created, so many things that God does. It just dwarfs us. This kind of thing, this kind of appeal to heavenly things should be weightier, should seem more urgent. You should feel the whole physical and spiritual universe come down on you when Jesus makes arguments like this. This is weighty. He may say it in one verse, and it may sound kind of strange, but this is the heavy hand of truth coming down upon you, trying to get you to live a certain way. So do not treat these kinds of arguments lightly. They may not be strictly ethical arguments, they may not be human-centered arguments, may not be horizontal arguments, but they are very much relevant, and even more so. They're weightier, they're grander, these theological arguments. So with that in mind, let's give this our attention. I'm going to move on to my third point then. So, trying to unpack these things with an attention to Jewish beliefs regarding angels. Christians should not despise another Christian because he has angelic protectors. That's the first thing I want to say about this. And we're going to see how this works again against the background of Jewish thought. And to begin with our background of Jewish thought, we're going to begin with the beginning of Jewish thought, which is the Old Testament. The Old Testament. In the Old Testament, we see that angels have a role in protecting the righteous. You perhaps don't see it very often, but it is there. The example which came to my mind among the first examples is one that is actually maybe a bit easy to miss. Maybe we're so familiar with the story that we kind of forget this part of it. But Daniel in the lion's den, if you want to think about this story. I want to use this familiar story as a good point of reference. But there is actually in this story an angel who comes to the rescue of a righteous person. Now the story is familiar. This is in Daniel chapter 6. I won't be there for long, but you can turn there if you want. The story is very familiar. Daniel, the Hebrew, is a higher-ranking servant of King Darius of Persia. Out of envy, Daniel's opponents set up a trap for him, that whole thing with making prayer to any god besides the king illegal, And Daniel prays anyway. He gets busted for that. And so the punishment is being thrown into a den of lions. So they throw him in the den of lions. They shut the stone over him. And the king says, well, Daniel, I hope God's able to save you because I can't do anything. And they just kind of leave him there until morning. We'll pick up the story here in Daniel chapter 6, verse 19. Read through verse 22. Then the king arose at dawn, at the break of day, and went in haste to the lion's den. When he had come near the den to Daniel, he cried out with a troubled voice. The king spoke and said to Daniel, Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God, whom you constantly serve, been able to deliver you from the lions? Then Daniel spoke to the king, O king, live forever. My God sent his angel and shut the lions' mouths, and they have not harmed me, insomuch as I was found innocent before him, and also toward you, O king, I have committed no crime. So there you have one example of an angel protecting the righteous in the Old Testament. You could go back further, maybe to Genesis, where you have the angels that go to Sodom, you know, getting Lot and trying to get Lot and his family out of the city. They don't do very well with that, mainly because of their stubbornness, but you see them protecting Lot at least and getting some of them out of there. You could go to other places where you see angels protecting people, but just basically the idea in the Old Testament, you see angels acting for the protection of faithful, righteous people. Now that fact was not lost on the minds of later Jewish authors. The Jews very much continued and held to this belief that the angels out there are very much interested in the protection of righteous people. And every now and then you encounter this in their writings, maybe just for the fun of it, but I'm going to give you an example here. My personal favorite of these is from the book of Tobit. I don't know if you've ever heard of this one. This is an apocryphal book. So if you've ever heard of the book collection called the Apocrypha, this is one of those books. And if you ever have the desire or the curiosity to actually read the Apocrypha, I recommend starting with the book of Tobit because it's a lot of fun. I find it to be a very entertaining book, not to trivialize the work of some man some years ago, but I do find it rather fun. The book of Tobit has two plot lines. One plot is about a righteous man named Tobit who has gone blind and is so grieved that he wants to die. Okay, so kind of a startling beginning there. A righteous man who has gone blind so much and so full of grief that he just feels like he's done with living. The other plot line is about a righteous young woman named Sarah who wants to be married, but a certain demon is obsessed with her and kills every man who tries to marry her. Yes, that is the other plot line of the book of Tobit. So you kind of get to reading this book and you're like, how is this going to turn out? I mean, there's a lot of different things happening here. Well, in the book of Tobit, to remedy that situation, God sends an angel named Raphael, long before there was an artist named Raphael, long before there was a Ninja Turtle named Raphael. But an angel named Raphael, his name means healing of God or medicine of God, and he's there to help. So in the course of the story, he takes Tobit's son, a guy named Tobias, and he teaches him how to heal his father and drive away this demon so that he can marry Sarah and so that his father can get his sight back and they all live happily ever after. It's kind of like a fairy tale. Well, anyway, I give you that example just because it's a very entertaining example in Jewish literature of how they viewed angels as intervening on the behalf of the righteous. If there are righteous people, you can bet there's some angel on the way to come and help them. It was very much on the mind of Jewish people around the time of Jesus that's what angels do. But of course, the greatest example of this is not from fiction, like the book of Tobit, but from the fact that at times these angels help Jesus himself. When the Son of God actually becomes a man and brings upon himself the weaknesses of mankind, there are angels that come and help him. There are a few events. Just to stick to Matthew, there is the one in the temptation of Christ in chapter 4, verse 11. The way the temptation ends, it's the kind of thing you might miss. After the devil fails to successfully tempt Jesus to sin, it says that the devil departs from him and angels appear to him and minister to him. He's out there in the desert. He hasn't had any food in 40 days. He just got tempted by the devil. So now these angels come to strengthen him. I always envision them as bringing food or something. But one way or another, they actually serve Jesus at that time. They help him out. You know, being really having survived that temptation by the devil himself, proving himself to be the most righteous person who ever lived, and here come the angels to help this righteous man. Same kind of thing. All that to say, there are these angelic protectors. It goes back to the Old Testament. Jews knew that. They maintained that in their memory. And in the very life of Jesus himself, we see this, that there are these angelic protectors of righteous people. And yet, in spite of that, despite the fact that there are these angels out there watching over the righteous, you and your fellow conspirators would dare to despise a righteous, faithful person under angelic protection. Right? Isn't that the problem? I mean, when you out there, you see this person, this other Christian, and you just want to put them at a distance. You don't really want to deal with them, treating them with disdain. You're doing that even though there are angels who are concerned about that person's well-being and very much intervene when that person is afflicted. That's what you're doing. You are despising not just that person, but the angelic guard that works for that person and for that person's well-being. I consider that, first of all, a great futility. I mean, here you are. Do you really think that your petty attitude or whispering under your breath or, you know, thinking terrible things about this person in your heart, do you really think that's going to do anything in the long run to a person who has angels serving him? Do you honestly think you're going to accomplish anything? No, it's futility. It's utter futility. And not only that, it's also stupidity. I'm not sure which one is worse, but it's also pretty stupid. You know why? Those angels can get pretty violent. You ever read the Old Testament? When the angels show up, they're not these, you know, girly-looking, effeminate things that come and throw flowers at you. They usually come with a sword and start killing people. It happens quite a bit. Are you really going to risk angering them? I mean, you're going to treat this person under their protection with just complete disdain, and you think you're just going to get away with that? And you might console yourself and say, well, I'm under their protection too. You know, angels care about me too. They're not going to hurt me. They're not going to do anything to me. I'm a Christian too. I'm under their guard. Okay? Parents, you love all your children, right? Fair to say you love all your children, okay? If one of your children hits the other child, are you still going to spank the child that did the hitting? Yeah, okay? Even though you love that child, you're going to give that child what he needs, what he deserves at that moment. You're going to give him punishment. Kids, you can back me up on that. Your parents may love you, but they're going to discipline you when you do wrong. Okay, angels are like that. Okay, they're like that. We all may be under angelic guard, but if we turn on each other, they're going to set it straight. They're not going to suffer that. They're not going to allow that to happen. If they see a bunch of us mistreating one Christian, they're going to do something. It's going to happen. And that is, I think, the first part of Jesus' argument. There are these angelic protectors of these Christians who are being despised. Do not set yourself at odds with those angelic protectors. Jesus puts an angel on your shoulder in this passage, and the angel's packing a bazooka, and he's pointing at your head, okay? Warning you, don't mess with another Christian. Don't despise them. They're all under angelic guard. Do not treat them lightly. Do not despise them. That's the first part of Jesus' argument, I think. The second part, this is actually my fourth point if that's confusing for you, but the second part of his argument, I think, and this one I think is a little more on the surface. Christians should also not despise another Christian because his angels have prestige because of him. I'm using that word prestige. For those of you who don't know that word, children in particular, prestige is when you hold someone in very high regard. You think very highly of them. You think they're very important. You think they're very grand. You think they're awesome. You think they're great. That's prestige. And these angels have prestige because of this lowly Christian that you're despising, which doesn't make any sense for you to do that, but you're doing it anyway because you're a sinner and you're in the wrong. Nonetheless, that's the argument here, that these angels have prestige because of this Christian, and therefore you should not despise that Christian. So you have this phrase here in verse 10. He says, "See to it that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels in heaven continually see the face of my Father who is in heaven." These angels are always looking at the face of God. Okay, let's think about that. Let's unpack that idea of these angels always looking at the face of God. To start with the Old Testament, we do see that all angels have some access to God's presence. Okay? All angels have some access to God's presence. Okay? And there are a few passages, or maybe you can see that. I think the clearest is in 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 19. We're just going to jump into the middle of a story here. This is when the prophet Micaiah is giving his prophecy to the two kings, the king of Israel and the king of Judah, and he's opposing the plan to go to war. And he sees this vision, and he tells them about this vision he had. And Micaiah said, "Therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, and all the host of heaven standing by him, on his right hand and on his left hand." So here's this vision he has of God and all the host of heaven. It wasn't just, you know, some of the angels that were invited. All the host of heaven were there with God in this vision. Okay? So from that you see that, at least to some degree, sometimes, all angels have some access to God. So there are at least some occasions where every single angel can get there and be in the presence of God, at least sometimes. Now, we can also say, going further with that, that some angels have more access to God's presence than others. Okay, so we have kind of a juxtaposition here. You have all angels having some access to God's presence, but then some angels have even more access to God's presence. And one place where you see this, I think, in Scripture, it is perhaps only hinted at, but it is there, especially when you read it against the background of Jewish writings, which I'll point out here in a moment. But Luke chapter 1, where the angel Gabriel shows up. Okay? This is when Gabriel appears to Zacharias, the father of John the Baptist, and is going to give him this message that his son John's going to be a great person and all that. Well, he describes himself in a particular way. He describes himself as Gabriel who stands in the presence of God. Luke 1, verse 18, he says, "Zacharias said to the angel, 'How will I know this for certain? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years.'" How are we going to know we're going to have a child? I mean, I know you're an angel, but how do I know you're telling the truth? I mean, I guess, okay, whatever. And Gabriel gets a bit indignant at that, and I think we can understand why. "The angel answered and said to him, 'I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and bring you this good news.'" Okay? Gabriel describes himself as the one who stands in the presence of God. The implication being that not every angel gets to stand in the presence of God. If every angel were always standing around in the throne room of God, Gabriel wouldn't explain himself that way. It'd be like, you know, saying, you know, "I'm Stan, and, you know, I am an American." It's like, well, there's like 300 million of us. It's not really very descriptive, is it? The idea that he explains himself as, "I am Gabriel who stands in the presence of God," implies that not every angel gets to. And you actually do see this when you look at it in the background of Jewish writings. From time to time, when the Jews are dealing with angels in a lot of their writings, and especially the more apocalyptic writings, you see this phrase show up, "angels of the presence." It's literally angels of the face, but it's usually translated angels of the presence. And these are the angels that get to stand in the presence of God. Not all of them do. There are usually some select group of angels that get to stand there in the presence of God all the time. The rest of them are kind of out on the periphery. But there are some angels that get to be right there with God all the time. And, you know, that differs depending on what authors' opinions are dealing with. But Gabriel seems to use that language. I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God. I'm one of these angels of the presence. How dare you accuse me of lying? When I say something's going to happen, it's going to happen. Why? Because I heard it from God directly. I stand in God's presence all the time. That's the idea. And so the Jews generally, and then here in Luke we see this, have this idea that you have some angels that get to be in God's presence far more often than the other angels who are only there some of the time. Okay? Now let's take that knowledge and assess what Jesus says. According to Jesus, angels who help Christians are allowed to see God always. Right? That's how he words it. He says, "See to it that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels in heaven continually see the face of my Father who is in heaven." They continually see the face of God. Look at this with Jewish eyes. You learn about these angels, maybe when you're very young, maybe when you're a child, you learn about these angels, and you learn that some of these angels get to stand in God's presence. They're always there. I mean, of the holy angels, they seem to be the holiest. I mean, they're right there in the throne room all the time. And you wonder to yourself, what kind of angel gets to be with God all the time? What kind of angel gets to hang around in the throne room always? Well, Jesus answers that question. He answers it seemingly out of his own knowledge of heavenly things, which isn't too surprising, he's been there. But he answers that these angels, these who are, you know, sticking up for Christians, these little ones, these angels are the ones who get to stand in God's presence all the time. The image is that these little ones, these insignificant believers, always have a spokesman on their behalf before God. And these angels are always ready to receive orders from God for the help of Christians. They're standing right there in God's presence, waiting to go when God says go. When God says go help that Christian, they're ready. I mean, they're right there waiting for orders. Or when this Christian needs help, that angel there who is always there in God's presence can speak right there, "Hey God, one of your people down here needs help. Let's get on this." And then the moment God says go, he goes. And he can do that because he's always there, except when he's leaving to go do something for the aid of another, for the aid of a Christian. That's apparently the only time he leaves. So that's the imagery here. I mean, these angels have unhindered, unlimited, unbroken access to God because of these little Christians. Because God wants these little Christians to have the utmost help, he has ordained an order of angels to always be right there in his presence, speaking on their behalf and going out to act on their behalf. That's how important we are to God, and that's what these angels are doing, and that's why these angels have this prestige of being right there in the throne room. They got promoted to that status because these Christians need help. That's why they're there. And so I say, bringing this around to Jesus's point, only a great fool would despise someone who is responsible for an angel's place of honor in God's presence. If this person here is responsible for that angel getting promoted to the very throne room of God to be an angel of the presence, why would you despise this person over here? Clearly that's not right. That's out of step. These awesome spirits get promoted because of their association with us. I mean, that's amazing. And yes, even the one you don't like, even the Christian you don't like, because that person is a Christian and God cares about him, an angel got a promotion because of him, or several angels, who knows? Yes, that applies even to those Christians you don't like. So, what's your problem? What is your problem? You're sitting there saying, "Oh, this guy, I was hoping he wouldn't show up today. I get really nervous when he shows up. You know, I just wish he would go away." What is your problem? There are angels who are eagerly waiting for some order from God to go to the assistance of that person, or angels praying on his behalf in the very presence of God. And here you are saying, "Ugh, I don't like that guy. I don't like that woman. Yeah, I know they're a Christian, but I just really don't like them." What is your problem? Why would you do that? It doesn't make any sense when you consider what this little measly Christian that you don't like has done in the heavenly realm. He is responsible for an angel getting prestige in the very presence of God. So why would you mistreat such a person? Why would you not embrace that person? Doesn't make any sense when you think about it from a heavenly perspective. So that was the, I think, second part of Jesus' argument. Now there's a third here. A third one that'll be very brief, but really sums all of this up. Christians should not despise another Christian because heaven is united in his favor. And Jesus stresses that fact by the way he words his saying here. He says something that isn't quite necessary, but he says it twice to really make sure you get this, and hopefully you're going to see it here. See that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels in heaven continually see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Now, heaven, repeated twice, the phrase in heaven, repeated twice. If I were to remove that phrase from the verse, you would still understand exactly what Jesus is saying. It would still make the same sense. Look, see that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that their angels continually see the face of my Father. Makes sense, right? You don't need the phrase in heaven, and you certainly don't need it twice. You assume that the angels are in heaven, and you assume that God is in heaven, because that's where they are, obviously. It doesn't seem like Jesus needs to say that, and yet he tells you that twice. These angels are in heaven, God's in heaven, and he wants to make sure you know that. Now, the implication of this, and the point I want to make, is that we, in our sinfulness, we might be united against that one Christian, but heaven is united in the favor of that Christian. Okay, we might all agree to just ostracize this person, or maybe just silently agree, not really talk about it, but just do it by instinct. We may all agree to kind of shove this person away. Meanwhile, heaven is actively working, all of heaven is working for the active benefit of that person. While you're down here on earth muttering to yourself or whispering to each other about that weird Christian that none of you like, God and the angels are having board meetings about the welfare of that same believer. So while you're gathering around here and talking amongst yourselves about this person that you don't like, God and the angels, they're like, how are we going to bring this person along in godliness? How are we going to protect him from temptation? How are we going to protect him from harm? What are we going to do about those Christians that are muttering under their breath about him? I mean, that's what they're doing. Heaven is up there doing that, and you're down here, I don't like that person. That's what you're doing. Meanwhile, all of heaven is united in their favor. I cannot imagine a behavior among Christians that would be so disconnected from God's plan and God's activities right now. I mean, right now, stuff like that is happening. You know, God and his angels are doing stuff for all these lone Christians that no one down here cares about, even in the church. There's a disconnect there that doesn't make any sense and needs to be rectified, which is why Jesus commands us not to despise another Christian. It's completely out of step with everything God is doing. So that, I think, is how we would unpack what Jesus commands here in this verse. And I will give you a summary here. As I said, that Christians should not despise another Christian. That's the basic commandment. And I did emphasize that I think it's Christians despising a particular Christian, one Christian. I think that's the scenario Jesus has in view, and he says we should not do that, that Christians should not despise another Christian, singular. Secondly, Christians should not despise another Christian because of angels. And here I made my argument that we're going to view this in light of a very Jewish perspective, because I think that's what Jesus had in mind and what Matthew had in mind. So that's sort of the course of this message as I was preaching it. My third point, Christians should not despise another Christian because he has angelic protectors. Here focusing on the protective role of angels, that this lone Christian that everyone else despises has angelic guardians, and therefore you should be wary of mistreating this Christian. Fourthly, Christians should not despise another Christian because his angels have prestige because of him. You know, this lowly believer that no one likes is responsible for angels standing in God's presence, so you should respond to that by honoring that Christian rather than despising him. And then finally, Christians should not despise another Christian because all of heaven is united in his favor. Jesus emphasized heaven twice in this verse. God and his angels together, working together for the good of this one believer whom you would dare to despise, whom multiple Christians would dare to despise, which is not right and completely out of step with God's plan. Therefore, we should not do that. And that is, as I called it, the earthly good of a heavenly mind. When you ponder these things from a heavenly vantage point, God and his angels working for this one Christian, you will not be able to bring yourself to despise him. You will feel convicted every time you're tempted to do so. And hopefully you will repent of that and change your ways toward that Christian and treat him with love and respect rather than despising him. I did want to read one more passage here at the end. The lengthiest passage that I plan to read. 2 Kings chapter 6, starting in verse 8. You know, this is a story that may seem unrelated, but I do want to draw a point from it, and we will come around to the point that I think you'll see. But I want to read some of the context first. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8. Now the king of Aram was warring against Israel, and he counseled with his servants, saying, "In such and such a place shall be my camp." Then the man of God, that's Elisha, by the way, in this context. Elisha is the prophet being described. You'll see his name later on. Then the man of God sent word to the king of Israel, saying, "Beware that you do not pass by this place, for the Arameans are camping there." The king of Israel sent to the place about which the man of God had told him. Thus he warned him, so he guarded himself there more than once or twice. So Elisha, really foiling the plans of the Arameans here as they send these military bands, these squads of soldiers into Israel, it gets pretty old here from the Aramean standpoint. I mean, there's this prophet always meddling with our plans because he knows what we're doing. Now the heart of the king of Aram was enraged over this thing, and he called his servants and said to them, "Will you tell me which one of us is for the king of Israel? Who's the spy? You know, who's relating my commands to the king of Israel?" One of his servants said, "No, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom." You know, so there you are, speaking in the most private context possible, and yet God hears it and tells his prophet about it, who then tells the Israelites about it, and therefore your plans are being foiled. So the king of Aram said, "Go and see where he is, that I may send and take him." And it was told him, saying, "Behold, he is in Dothan." He sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. Now when the attendant of the man of God had arisen and early and gone out, behold, an army with horses and chariots was circling the city. So it seems like Elisha is in trouble at this point. He's got a whole army surrounding him. And his servant said to him, "Alas, my master, what shall we do?" So Elisha answered, "Do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them." Then Elisha prayed and said, "O Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. So obviously an angelic army, if there are horses and chariots of fire. When they came down to him, Elisha prayed to the Lord and said, "Strike this people with blindness, I pray." So he, that's God, struck them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. Okay, so here you have another example of angels sticking up for the righteous. This one a very dramatic example of a whole army of angels showing up to help Elisha against a whole army of Aramaeans. Now, my final word to you on this matter of not despising another Christian because of the angels is this. Do not rewrite this story with yourself in the role of the Aramaeans. Okay? Don't be like that army of godless pagans going after this prophet and falling under the wrath of an angelic army. Because honestly, I say that because every time you do that, when you cast yourself against another believer, I don't care what the reason is, you put yourself against another believer so that you despise this believer. Every time you do that, you're making yourself like one of these Arameans. And it doesn't matter how many of you there are always more angels, and they're always more powerful than you. And that's not going to end well for you. This is a very self-seeking motive. I'm encouraging you to be selfish tonight and think about yourself, think about your own well-being. Don't end up on the wrong side of a battle with the angels, because they will stick up for the one righteous person that is being abused in any given situation. They will. It's their job. That's why God has them. They are ministering spirits sent out to minister on behalf of us, including those of us that are being attacked by other Christians. So don't be like the Aramaeans. That is my final exhortation to you as we think about not despising another Christian because of these angels. Remember, they are out there. They are active. They are the guardians of these Christians. So do not act contrary to another Christian. Do not despise them. Instead, treat them with the love that befits a brother and sister in Christ. And that, I think, is how we would unpack Jesus' statement and how Jesus himself would do it, I think, if he gave more detail. But that is my message for tonight. And if there are questions, we can answer those, or if there are comments, further observations, or whatever.